Christmas film, which deals with a very important aspect of factory production. My name is Dixon, and during the war years, I was the general manager of an aircraft factory employing about 14,000 people. That is where the film was taken, and I know something about the job of work which it illustrates. What exactly was this job, and why should it be of interest to you now? Well, you don't need any reminder from me of the importance of getting our production into its peacetime stride. We need every ton of raw material our mines can be made to yield. Our forges and blast furnaces must work at high pressure, because we can't begin to enjoy the fruits of victory until our ports are working all the traffic they can take, and our ships are carrying the products of our industry to the four corners of the earth. But materials, machinery, organization can't do everything. When all is said and done, industry is a human problem. It depends on the energy and keenness of the men and women behind the machines. Unless they have the vitality that comes from plenty of good, enjoyable food, they can't be expected to put their backs into the job. I am glad to pay my tribute to canteen workers, not only those in our own factory, but the thousands up and down the country who did such grand work during the war. I'm sure they will contribute greatly to our industrial efficiency in the years of peace.
Canteen organizations do a fine job in modern factories, a big job. Over 10,000 people are employed here, all sorts of people with all sorts of tastes and appetites. Their day starts early. Their midday break must be a real change, refreshing to their minds as well as to their bodies. Let's see how this is managed. First things first, we'll begin with the store.
Yes, and take it from me, a good storehouse is half the battle. We keep enough to stock a shop, and a good shop at that. We can't afford to be caught napping on supplies. This looks like a lot of sugar when you see it in bulk, but you'd be surprised how soon it all goes. We use over a ton a month of puddings, cakes, and pastries, as well as tea, of course. So this stock won't be here long. We buy our tea by the ton, too. Each of these chests will make 25,000 cups. Good cups, mind. Now people wouldn't say thank you for wish-wash, and neither would I, for that matter. It's the variety of things we keep that surprises some people. This is the corner of the tinned goods store. Then there's the hardware department. There's nothing here that you wouldn't need if you had our size family to keep house for. And even in the best regulated households, plates get broken sometimes.
The butcher's shop does things in a big way. Like most families, this one likes plenty of meat and gets it.
Roast beef today. A nice bit of beef at that. If you want fine meat, well cooked, this is the place to come for it. Delivered regular and kept in cool store till it's wanted. None of it reserved from the management either. We share and share alike, from the boss to the apprentices. Of course, there's a knack to it, putting up the joints convenient for the oven. But we are old hands here. Never have any complaints.
All our stores departments are run on the same lines. People drawing supplies are treated exactly like customers in an ordinary shop. The only difference is that instead of money, they bring chips for what they require. Their requisitions are checked as the goods are handed over. The organization is simple, but it's efficient. Everything is done quietly and unhurried. Careful planning ensures that. All the same, we don't forget that we're working for 0 hour. That is 12 noon. So we're glad to see the vegetables coming in early. All perishables are delivered daily. That's the only way to get them fresh and good. They go straight from the lorries to the kitchens, where plenty of willing hands are ready to prepare them for cooking.
Planing vegetables is one of the things that must be done by hand. we think good vegetables make all the difference to the flavor of the meat course. And so we take great care to clean and cook them properly. We handle hundredweight most days, but we're as particular with them all as you'd be yourself with just one. Potatoes, now they're different. You can go a long way peeling them by machine. Quick and easy, see? And a good thing, too, for we do bags of them. No one's ever invented a machine for taking the eyes out. We have to do that by hand. But there, they're done at last. Won't be long now till they go on to boil.
Well, that gives you an idea of what happens behind the scenes. Now we come to the kitchen and the actual cooking. The layout of these kitchens is important. Everything's planned for speed and smoothness. Remember, thousands of hot meals, cold meals, and snacks must be ready to the minute. And they will be. It's much quieter here than in the factory. Yet in the kitchen, there's the same order and efficiency. Have a look at these boilers. Giant pots with steam jackets round them to give a perfectly controlled, even heat. There are 8 of them for soup, vegetables, puddings, or what have you. The potatoes are just going in. So they look beautifully white and clean. And here are the cabbages going into the pot an hour or so after arriving from the farm.
This is where visitors begin to work up an appetite. This is real good soup, made of bone and vegetable stock. The very thing to warm the cockles of the heart on a cold day. I can recommend the joint. Brown, tender, done to a turn. Or maybe you'd fancy fish and chips. Hot fat frying is a speciality here. Done right, there's nothing tastier. But it must be done right. The fat sizzling hot. The food put in carefully and well drained when it comes out. And here are the chips to go with the fish. The secret of crispness is the heat of the fat and the basket for quick draining, all according to Mrs. Beaton. Here's a batch of fish cakes that'll go like the hot cakes they are.
But what about after?
They've not been forgotten. In fact, they've been made earlier on because they take time to cook. Here's a flashback to show today's roly-poly. Well spread, neatly tucked in. It's a favorite sweet, and do you wonder? Special tins for it, batteries of them. Now you see why modern jam rolls come out round. The tins are packed into a big pan and put into a steam-heated oven. We know to a minute how long they need. Of course, tastes differ. Some people prefer fruit and custard. Or pastry, perhaps. There's certainly no lack of choice.
Let's switch over to the bakery while we're talking of sweet things. It deals with another side of this canteen's activity, making cakes and buns for elevenses and afternoon teas, which go to the workers in the factory.
Queen of Hearts, that's me, if making jam tarts is anything to go by. I make thousands, and if I say it myself, they're good. We can turn out as many as 15,000 cakes and tarts in a day. You can understand seeing them why there's such a big demand. Rock cakes, maids of honor, cook cakes, and queen cakes. All the old favorites, and some new ones. The cakes are sent to the issue room, where they're handed out to the tea trolley girls.
The tea itself is made in standard size multi-pots from measured portions of tea and sugar. The machine weighs the correct quantity of tea into each bag. No guesswork. Every cup of tea is just as strong as every other cup. It keeps fresh and hot until it reaches the workers at their benches, because it's made in multi-pots.
There's always a welcome when we go around. Everybody in our factory has tea and cakes, morning and afternoon. Keeps us cheerful and
If you ask me, we work better for it.
There's another part of the canteen we've not yet seen, the snack counter. Now, this is really something. Lots and lots of fine, tasty dishes, light but satisfying for anyone who doesn't happen to fancy the joint.
The salads here are good man-sized meals. We ring the changes by adding cold meat, cheese, sardines. When I took charge of this counter, I'd an idea men didn't care for salads much. But you ought to see them go to these. They like our hot snacks, too. You'll see those soon. We're working on them now. Time is getting on, you know.
I expect that's what the people in the factories are thinking about now. By comparison, with all the activity going on there, the canteen looks very empty at the moment. But a lot is happening in the kitchen itself, in preparation for 0 hour.
Things are humming here, but the situation is well under control. Thank goodness, though, we don't have to carve by hand. It's done by machine. The slices fall away hot and nice before you could say knife. Now the meat goes to the plating up table. On a hot tray, mind you. And so to a hot plate. On these plates, a team of fast-working canteen helpers are already portioning out the potatoes and the cabbage. Everything's covered up right and tight and popped into the hot cupboards to keep hot. These cupboards back onto the serving counter.
Remember the hot snacks I mentioned? They're just ready. The menu speaks for itself. It's nothing out of the way. We do as many different dishes every day of the week. Here they are. But they'll not be here long.
On the main counter, pans holding soup, gravy, sauces are hoisted on. They must be dished up to order, so to speak. Sweets are being put on deck, with custard close by for whoever wants it. The whole organization is timed to have everything ready when the clock strikes.
0 hour, dinner time. Canteen doors open on the minute, and the hungry workers start coming in. The day's menu can be taken in at a glance. Those who want the main meal buy their tickets at one of the four kiosks, but most people get a week's supply at a time, so that they can go straight to the counter. There's no hold-up. Service is already in full swing. Workers under 18 get their food at half price, but that doesn't mean half portions. Their appetites are as big as the others, so they get the same size meal. Thanks to careful preparation and good organization, everyone gets served without delay. Above all, the hot meals really are hot. Some people have got to the sweets by now. Quick work. I'm afraid this is our last sight of that roly-poly. There's quite a run on the fruit tart, too. Most of the tables are getting filled up, but there's no push or panic. Everything goes smooth.
Of course, in a big place like this, there are always some who can't eat what the others eat. We cater for these special cases, though. The medical officer prescribes for them. The dietitian sees they get just what the doctor ordered.
Let's join the throng at the hot snacks, shall we? I'd like another look at those savory thingamabobs. I can't get over the wonderful variety. And remember, this is just a normal day's choice.
Come on, George. Make up your mind.
Grilled tomato and a Welsh, miss, please.
Mind my elbow there, chum. Two fish cakes, if you please.
Oh, You've heard of salad days. Well, now you're seeing one. Notice how the men are going for those nice, crisp platefuls. By the way, have you noticed the time? It's barely 10 minutes since the dinner whistle went, and already many workers are getting on with their meal. No need to bolt their food, they can relax and take things easy. Enjoying your sofa, eh, Bert?
Was I angry?
They're always thirsty for tea. Here it comes. The trolleys go round. No one need move.
A nice cup of tea now, and I wouldn't call the king me uncle.
Well, there it is. By 12:30, most of these men and women will have finished their dinner, and they'll have half an hour to call their own before they have to start work again. In this shot from the film Millions Like Us, you see the full extent of the main dining hall. Because every detail of the organization was well planned beforehand, it took just 12 minutes.